IPMNation.com.
Well, I think I have a very good relationship with some of the press, and unfortunately, some of the press doesn't cover me accurately. In fact, they go out of their way to cover me inaccurately, so I don't think that's a free press. I think that's a dishonest press. So I want to see freedom of the press, and I get treated fairly by some press, but I get treated very unfairly by other press, and frankly, I think that's very dishonest, and I don't consider that. When you have stories that are purposely written badly, in many cases, very much on purpose. I mean, you look at it, that's not free press. That's the opposite of free press. I thought it was a very positive conversation I had with President Putin.
Did you address the election meddling issues? Did you address the election meddling issues that came up in the Mueller report?
Did you tell them not to meddle in the next election?
Excuse me, you are very rude.
Did you tell them not to meddle?
We didn't discuss that.
I don't know why.
Monday, and the sun is finally out here in Manchester, New Hampshire. It is Matt Connerton Unleashed, and we are live coming to you from WMNH 95.3 FM in downtown Manchester, New Hampshire, a bright, sunny downtown Manchester. It seems like it's been just days since we've seen, well, it has been days. It doesn't seem like it. It literally has been days since we've seen consistent bright sunlight, but oh, it is glorious out. What a nice day. Of course, we are live on WMNH 95.3 and Comcast 97 if you're in Manchester. Of course, we're also streaming worldwide at WMNHradio.org and on Facebook via Facebook Live on the Matt Connerton Unleashed Facebook page, which is one of the ways that you can interact with the show today on this Monday, May 6, 2019. Another way is you can give us a call at 603-250-6007, 603-250-6007. Let's see, I already see Jenny in the Facebook live chat, as well as Tony Petrello. Hello, Tony. Orla Hart Shevlin says, "Hi, Matt, how are you?" And then says, "You." So I would have figured it out, Orla, but thank you. Nice to see you. Let's see. Oh, Jenny, just letting me know, we have a guest Thursday at 4:15 p.m. We'll be joined by Philip Robert, the founder and CEO of the Burning Limb Foundation. So that will be this Thursday at 4:15. Let's see. I want to... you know what? Sometimes I almost forget to introduce my my co-hosts because I can't actually see them. Of course, always. I just assume, you know, maybe someday he'll float away. He'll float off to the next plane of whatever. But I assume he's still with us. So I'll go ahead and mention him out. I'll, you know, conjure him and whatever. The ghost of John McCain, my official co-host.
I'm John McCain.
Yes, he is here. And, of course, as always, my... official,
I'm here.
Yep, my official co-host there, Dave Ridley. And, of course, our newest addition to the cast, Virtual John Hopwood.
Jesus, buddy.
But we have a call. Hi, welcome to Matt Connerton Unleashed. Who's this?
Hello, this is EZG.
EZG in the place to be.
I don't know why.
Oh, no, I'm sorry. It's Paul EC in the place to be. EZG is just EZG. How are you, EZG?
Just awful, but the thought I'd call to say quick hello.
Oh, well, now why are you just awful? Tell us your problems. What's the matter?
Oh, my feet.
Oh, my goodness. Well,
my feet and legs are still swelled up.
Sure, sure.
Even though I didn't go into Creamland today because the boss called me off, but rested most of the day, but that doesn't seem to do much good. On the good news front, though, I Facebooked Peter White in the morning show, and I'm going to have a special guest coming on. I don't know if you know this lady. She's coming on July 8th, Katie Dobbins.
Yes, Katie Dobbins has been on this program. I have interviewed her, and she is very, very talented. Yes.
She's a little more mellow. Music than Amanda does. Amanda's more rock and roll kind of girl.
Amanda's like heavy metal. But, she's crazy. She's out of control.
Amanda. Never been. So.
Amanda spits blood
on the
Rob and the whole
thing. Been on the show a couple times.
Yes.
She's going to be singing a song for on the at the bookery on the 24th
the
of
bookery,
May over
yes.
at the for his book signing.
Yes. Now, has Amanda played at the bookery?
There's going to be other artists there, too, apparently. So
they probably don't let Amanda play
there.
I've never met
Rob Azevedo. Obviously, you have.
I see him every Friday. Do they let Amanda play at the bookery,
or
is she too out of control because she's a big rock and roller?
Rob Azevedo, Katie Dobbins, or any other famous celebrities that he's going to have there. He's going to have a couple of artists over there because he's all about music, as you well know. He's a music guy.
No, I don't.
Right, yes, of course.
Yeah, so I'm excited to get her on the radio.
You can see it on the show.
Talk up our music career.
Yes.
My brain is clogged with all sorts of stuff. Twinkies.
Who put out a new album?
My neurons were wired on a mattress from a gambling program used on your social media.
Well, we'll have to.
My God.
Oh, we'll have to. Forgive me.
It came out April 30th.
I'm not an
birthday.
Imbecile.
Virtual John Hopwood is very chatty today.
Oh, wow. Yeah, sure. Ooh, yeah.
Have you met Virtual John Hopwood?
I don't think I have, no.
Oh, well.
But anyway,
when do the food stamps?
You can go down and pick up your keys now. Say hi.
All right. Well, thank you, Easy G.
Oh, and calling for the pepperoni pizza.
All right. Thank you. Easy G, Eric Gagnon leaves us. Yes. All right. Always nice to hear from Easy G. Eric, if you're still listening, I must apologize. Not only was Virtual Dave Ridley interrupting you, but Virtual John Hopwood kind of getting into the act as well. Fortunately, the ghost of John McCain is more of a broadcasting professional, and he really... you know, he understands that, you know, when there's a caller on the line, you have to kind of, you know, pull back a little bit and let the caller talk because callers often have a lot to say. So unlike Virtual Dave Ridley and Virtual John Hopwood.
I'm very happy with where we are.
Yeah, see, the ghost of John McCain really gets it. Let's see. Jenny in the Facebook live chat says, OMG, LMAO. Who is he talking to? Jeez. Who was who talking to? Easy G or Virtual Dave Ridley or Virtual John Hopwood? I don't know. It's pandemonium here in the studio today at WMNH 95.3 FM. It's pandemonium. Oh. Got the air horn and everything. The week is off to a rousing start. So I've decided something, my friends, as we proceed on the program. You know, I made an announcement last week that we would be going forward. If anyone called the show and started talking about Hillary Clinton, because I'm so sick of talking about the 2016 election, because there's this 2020 election. I don't know if you're aware, but we're kind of fully into that election cycle right now. But very often when I discuss Trump or the Trump administration or criticisms of such, supporters of the president will call and go into the whole butter emails Benghazi thing as if that's relevant to anything I'm discussing. And so I decided, because I don't see that ending anytime soon, I'm sure 20 years from now, you know, as people look back and discuss the Trump presidency, those who supported him will be talking about Hillary's emails and Benghazi. So I made the decision last week that I would, anytime anyone called and started talking about Hillary's emails or Benghazi, because I'm just bored to death with it, I would play a bit of the song Time Traveler by Kiss. But I've come up with something better, although Kiss is my favorite band. So I just want folks to be aware that going forward, if you call the show and begin to discuss Hillary Clinton, because I'm just sick to death of those conversations, I'm going to play this little ditty, and I'm going to play it for you right now. Now, what will happen is, just so you're aware, and those of you who call and do that, you know who you are, just so you're aware, I will not interrupt you. I will let you say your piece. I know that to some folks, whenever I have any criticisms of Trump, you know, butter emails and Benghazi are just, you know, the you just can't wait to call and blurt those out. Apropos of nothing, in my opinion, but I get it. That's just, you know, how some folks are wired. I will let you say your piece. I will not talk over you. I will not interrupt you. You can do that. It's part of your thing. And I already know that during the 2020 campaign, Trump will devote much time and resources to rerunning the 2016 campaign and, you know, will be leading crowds in chants of lock her up and all that, even though Hillary Clinton won't be his opponent. I realize that. I can already see that coming. He'll probably spend more time running against Hillary Clinton than he will against whoever the Democratic nominee is. Wouldn't surprise me at all. I say that not even kidding. That would not surprise me at all. Hey, why not? It won the first time. Just pretend she's the nominee. Oh, hello to G-Girl in the Facebook live chat who says, hey, what's poppin'? So here's what I'm going to do. And if you call and start talking about Hillary Clinton, like I said, you can say your piece, but there will be something playing in the background. I'm going to play. It's only about a minute and a half. I might have to loop it for those of you who want to go on and on and on about Hillary Clinton, but I'm going to play the song for you right now, uninterrupted. This is by one of my favorite YouTubers, Placeboing. It's called Chauvinist, Sexist, Misogynist, the Hillary Clinton Remix. And here it is. Enjoy this, because you're probably going to be hearing a lot of it. There you go. I wonder if DJ Midas has ever played that on Late Night Delight on Saturday nights here on WMNH. So that will be playing in the background when you call and you begin to talk about Hillary's emails and Benghazi. Just so y'all know. Okay. Very, very exciting. It'll help me get through the tedium of listening to folks ramble on about that. Bleach bidding and all that. You know, I'm over it. Maybe some of you are too. All right, so we have very, very important things to discuss today, my friends. As always, we've got two really, really big stories that I think we need to discuss today on the show. One of them, of course, is William Barr. You know, Nancy Pelosi says William Barr lied to Congress, committed perjury to Congress. William Barr, of course, on Wednesday, I believe they will formalize charges of contempt in the House against William Barr for not showing up to the second hearing that was supposed to happen in the House, et cetera, et cetera. So we have to talk about William Barr today. The other big story that I think everyone's talking about that we must address on the show, and this might actually be the bigger story of the two. I can't quite decide. So I think we might go with this one first. From my favorite website, and hopefully yours, rightwingwatch.org, Mark Taylor, the so-called firefighter prophet, you know, because he's a, I guess he's a firefighter, and he can see the future. He's a prophet, because God talks to him and stuff. And we've discussed Mark Taylor many times on the show, and we always learn so much from him. According to Mark Taylor, Satan is using chemtrails to block God's frequency. Can you even believe that? Wow. This is a stunning revelation, my friends. We need to know more about this if this is in fact true. Now, there are those who would claim, first of all, let's start with the chemtrails, a very common topic among the conspiracy-minded, you conspiracy theorists out there. Now, my understanding from more reasonable folks is that there is no such thing as chemtrails, and they are simply contrails, and they're the result of condensation in the air when an airplane is traveling. If there's a lot of condensation in the air, it leaves what leaves behind what looks like a trail of clouds. Those who believe in chemtrails will tell you that what's actually going on is they're spraying some sort of poison into the air that I guess is supposed to brainwash all of us somehow so that the Illuminati or the deep state or whatever, the reptilian shapeshifters that actually control the earth can have their way with us or whatever the purpose of that is. I'm not exactly clear. Those, of course, who don't believe in chemtrails and say, no, they're just contrails, say that, that's ridiculous. Who do you believe? Right? I mean, you know, one theory sounds completely insane, and then there's the scientific explanation, but who needs science? Am I right? So, I mean, science is overrated. I mean, random made-up crap is so much more interesting.
Science!
And I wasn't good at science in school anyway. So we'll just go with the random made-up crap. Now, there is also, by the way, those who believe in the chemtrails will tell you that part of their bits of evidence, and I'm no expert on this, but part of their bits of evidence is look at the increase. When you look at the skies, especially when if you live near an airport, like, for example, here in Manchester, New Hampshire, we have Manchester Airport or Manchester Boston Regional Airport, officially as it's told, a topic of some resentment for some people. They would rather it just be Manchester Airport, not Manchester Boston. Anyway, some folks see the presence of Boston in the name as, it's like Boston is an interloper. We're not a suburb of Boston, right? So why is it Manchester Boston, which is actually a good point. At least Manchester is first, regardless of that. So if you live near an airport, those who believe in chemtrails will tell you, hey, haven't you ever noticed as that you see a lot more of these trails now than when you were a kid? Now you see them all the time and you'll see a whole lot of them, whereas when you were a kid you might see fewer, right? And then those who prefer a more science-based explanation will tell you that no, the reason you see so many more of them now is because now there are a lot more planes than there used to be because there's more people. So there's more people traveling around and there's more planes and more airports, etc. So
science.
But again, I mean, the scientific explanation, why go with that? I mean, it's so much easier to just, not easier, but more fun, right? I mean, yes, there is some cognitive dissonance required to believe that airplanes are traveling around and releasing poisonous gas into the atmosphere. But if we're going to go down that route or route, depending on your preference of pronunciation, I say we should just go full bore and go with something really crazy sounding. And apparently, Mr. Mark Taylor, the firefighter prophet, had the same idea because he's claiming that that it is Satan who is actually causing the chemtrails. Now, I must tell you, if this is true, and let's give him the benefit of the doubt, shall we? You know, when we get into this stuff, it's kind of the unofficial policy of the show, as I say all the time. Let's listen, because I'm going to play the audio of him explaining this in a moment. Not only with open minds, but with open hearts as well, which I think is nice. I think it's a nice thing to do, right? I mean, he is a fellow human. Let's give him that respect. As we... as I'm reading this earlier, I'm thinking that Satan, if he's right, again, let's give him the benefit of the doubt for a moment. If he's right, that Satan is pretty crafty. I mean, think about what he's managed to pull off, right? I mean, he turned himself into a snake and got, you know, Eve to pick the apple and share with Adam, right? And then he planted dinosaur fossils all over the world to fool us into questioning that the Earth is only 6,000 years old, and got people thinking about evolution. And then he managed to, I mean, this is probably his greatest trick ever, right? This dude, Satan, right? He actually managed to convince like 97-98% of the world's scientists that there's this made up thing. Climate change is actually real. I mean, my goodness, the guy just,
science.
The guy is incredible and incredibly evil. But so this is apparently this is among his many tricks. Let's listen to Mark Taylor explain Satan and the chemtrails. That's which I believe is also the name of a Black Sabbath song. There we go. This will be instructive and informative, I'm sure. If it'll actually play, I think the deep state might be messing with my computer here. I click play, but it's not playing. I got a spinning wheel. Did I lose internet? I'm going to try refreshing this page, my friends. I apologize for the delay. I know you're all anxious to learn more from Mark Taylor. He is the firefighter prophet, after all. All right, here we go.
Frequency. You know, the clothes I'm wearing, whatever, the carpet in the hat in the room, the trees, the grass.
Let me back this up. I want to make sure we get the very beginning of this. Here we go.
Everything in life gives off a frequency. You know, the clothes I'm wearing, you know, whatever, the carpet in the room, the trees, the grass. That's why the Bible says when no one else will, the rocks will cry out to me, because all of creation cries out to God in that frequency.
Let me just say this. I once had an experience where I was walking in the woods. There's three reasons why I avoid today. I avoid ever going into the woods. I mean, aside from being probably about the least outdoorsy human you've ever met or will meet or could meet if you haven't met me, but you might. I'm just not very outdoorsy, my friends. But there's really three reasons I don't go in the woods. One is I'm afraid of coming in contact with a tick and contracting Lyme disease. Number two, I was called recently by a terrifying woodland creature named Yuglis, who sounded very friendly, but apparently he steals things from people. And number three, I had an experience once where I was walking in the woods, and just as Mark Taylor describes here, there were rocks actually crying out to me, or so it seemed. Now, when discussing this with some friends later, it turned out that I had ingested something that perhaps I shouldn't have. But it seemed as though rocks were crying out to me as I was walking in the woods. It was a terrifying experience. Anyway, okay.
They're actually worshiping. I believe it's actually worshiping God, creation
itself.
Creation itself. I mean, you know, the trees, the rocks, whatever the case may be, everything he's created. Because we're created to worship, you know.
That's why Satan creates a new frequency to try to control
us. To combat that, to block that. And the problem is that once we come so far generationally, we've got so many things going on, whether it's the foods we eat, the chemtrails, all the spraying, is to detract us from hearing God's frequency. Because when you think about it, they're spraying aluminum and barium in the chemtrails. And if you look on the periodic table, barium and aluminum, barium is BA, aluminum is AL, spells Baal.
By the way, can't you get a barium cream donut at over at Bill's Donuts? Is that a coincidence? Oh, hello to Wayne Noel and Rhonda Ostrowitz Favero in the Facebook live chat.
Coincidence.
Oh, wow.
No coincidence.
That's deep.
That's deep. That's no coincidence.
Wait, what did he say was deep? I don't think he actually said anything deep. Let me back that up a little bit, because the other guy, who's this other guy with him? I don't know. I guess I don't care. But I didn't hear him, but whoever this guy is, he thinks that Mark Taylor just said something really deep. I need to back this up and hear that again. And we need to assess if he actually did say something deep. Let's see.
And if you look on the periodic table, barium and aluminum. Barium is BA, aluminum is AL, spells Baal. No coincidence.
By the way, it's always interesting when people who fundamentally reject science in favor of sorcery. Start talking about science.
Science!
Wow.
No coincidence.
That's deep.
That's deep. That's no coincidence.
Yeah.
So when you look at this,
whatever,
Rick, we are literally walking
deep
antennas.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Because we've been breathing the aluminum. We've been breathing the barium. It's saturated all the foliage. This is why you had the fires out there in California.
Isn't it pronounced foliage? He says it saturated all the foliage. I mean, you know, I don't want to question the firefighter prophet, but I'm a stickler for pronouncing things correct. Maybe I've been saying it wrong. Maybe it's foliage. I've never heard anyone pronounce it foliage before.
So these guys out there were saying these fires were literally exploding. They couldn't control them. Mm-hmm. That's why, is because aluminum itself.
They were literally exploding? Oh, my goodness. Well, that, to me, I think would be evidence of climate change.
Science!
I mean, when you have exploding trees, literally exploding, he said, that's when you know the earth is getting very, very hot.
Burn at 1,200 degrees. Mm-hmm. So the foliage has been saturated with this stuff. So when you look at everything that we're eating, the heavy metals, toxicity that everyone has, we are literally giant antennas, which was intended. So if you want to get really deep on this, these entities that the devil has put down.
Hang on, everybody. Make sure you're paying attention. Pay close attention, because apparently we're about to get very deep on this. Let me back this up a little bit. I don't want to miss any of this. This is the really deep part. Are you ready?
So if you want to get really deep on this, these entities that the devil has put down here, that these Satanists worship, or, you know, tap into for this knowledge, if you will, they've told them how to do this stuff. Mm-hmm. They've showed them how to do this stuff for decades. I mean, for thousands of years. But they've tapped into this stuff of how to clog up man's ears and eyes and be able to sense and feel God every time you're walking around.
Okay. What does that have to do with chemtrails? Did I miss something? Because the article is titled, Mark Taylor says Satan uses chemtrails to block God's frequency. I didn't hear anything about chemtrails in there. Or is that what he was saying? Okay. Oh, no, he did say it. Because there's a transcript here. It says, the chemtrails, all this spraying is to detract us from hearing God's frequencies. He meant distract, but he said detract. They are spraying aluminum and barium in the chemtrails. And if you look at the periodic table, barium is B-A, aluminum is A-L. It spells Baal, Baal, B-A-A-L. That's the thing that was so deep. See, I had to read it. I had to read it to fully comprehend the genius and the depth and the complexity of what the firefighter prophet was saying there. Just listening to it, it went over my head. As it would, of course, because he's, you know, I'm one of those pro-gay marriage people. So, of course, I'm not going to get it. He probably thinks I'm one of the Satanists. He probably thinks I'm one of the people who puts the stuff in the planes that they spray. But, you know, but no, now that I'm reading it, I get it. The chemtrails, basically what he's really saying is, let's kind of boil it down, shall we? Because I'm someone who's not good at science, but I think I can grasp broader concepts. He's saying that airplanes are spraying Satan, is what he's really saying. They're spraying Satan onto the earth. Coincidentally, when I was in high school, some friends and I had a death metal band called Spraying Satan. But that would probably not surprise some of you to know that. Well, there you have it. So Mark Taylor, the firefighter prophet, once again, sharing some of his wisdom with all of us. Whether you choose to believe it or not, there it is. Let's see. Let's go ahead. Well, it's about 4:35. We'll go ahead and we'll get into, I don't know. Maybe I want to save it for the 5 o'clock hour. Well, let's hit a couple other things first, at least. Joe Biden is a new poll shows Joe Biden with a 32-point lead over Sanders for the Democrats. Part of why this got my attention is, so I think we can safely say at this point, Biden being a little bit handsy apparently didn't do him any harm, and he's been able to move past that. All right, so you can check that off. Oh, Jenny says, no, the fires were from lack of raking. Oh, referring to the fires that Mark Taylor was talking about. Yes. Well, you know what Trump said? You gotta rake your forest. That's what they do in Finland. It was Finland, right? The president of Finland told him, we don't have forest fires because we rake. And then it turned out the president of Finland said, no, I actually never said that to Trump. Not that President Trump would make anything up. Let's see. Rhonda says, Anton LaVey is rolling in his grave right now. Yes. Yes. So former VP Joe Biden has a 32-point lead in the Democratic presidential race in a Hill-Harris-X poll released today. Biden won 46% in the poll compared to 14% for Senator Bernie Sanders, who came in a distant second place. There's more to this. We can get into this a little bit more, but part of why this got my attention is, if y'all haven't noticed, there appears to be a general election campaign taking place already. Trump and Biden have been trading shots. I mean that rhetorically, but also they've been talking about how much they want to actually physically beat each other up, which is exciting. I said on Facebook, I think it should be the main event for WrestleMania 36. Why not? Donald Trump technically is already a wrestling character in WWE. He was involved in a few different storylines over the years and is in the celebrity wing of the WWE Hall of Fame. And that is true. I say that not to be funny. That actually literally is true. So I think it would be fascinating, and maybe we should do that. Maybe we should decide the presidency that way, instead of the Electoral College. You know, some think we should ditch the Electoral College, for the popular vote, strictly for the presidency. I think we should do it at WrestleMania and do that instead. Now, it would have to be, though, what they call a shoot fight, and a shoot is when it is not scripted. Not predetermined at all, unlike a work. A work is when you, it's carny talk, basically. A work is when something is predetermined. A shoot is when you just, you know, it's real. So it'd have to be a shoot fight, to be fair. Oh, hello to Greg Saltz in the Facebook live chat. Hello, Greg. But they appear to be, both Biden and Trump appear to be, you know, already waging a general election campaign, in the sense that, like I said, Trump has been attacking Biden. He hasn't really been, I mean, he's attacked Bernie a little bit. He likes to refer to him as Crazy Bernie. Trump was very upset with Fox News when they did that Bernie Sanders town hall. He was displeased that Bret Baier and I forget who the other one was who was there with Bret, they were actually nice to Bernie. I don't know what they were expecting, if they thought, you know, maybe Bernie would take his seat on that stage and then Tucker Carlson was going to come running in and just slap him or something. I don't know what Trump expected, but I remember a particular tweet. He's like, oh, yeah, Fox had Bernie on and they were smiling and they seemed like they were happy to see him or whatever it was. It was like, well, yeah, I don't know what you wanted out of that. Hello to Chris Rose, who joins us in the Facebook live chat. But Trump lately has been, seems to be directing all his ire at Joe Biden, and Joe Biden directing all of his ire at Trump. Joe Biden, I don't think, has been talking about any of his opponents for the Democratic nomination. And as long as he's maintaining this huge lead, I mean, this is a big lead. This lead that he has in this current poll, I dare say, is on the level that Trump had when Trump announced his candidacy and when the debates started up leading into the Republican primaries in 2016. Trump had this giant lead. That's why I always thought Trump was going to be the nominee. I did not think that Trump was going to win the presidency, but I did think he was going to be the nominee very early when a lot of other people thought he'd peter out, because he had this gigantic lead. He had a lead similar to the one Biden has now, where he was, you know, into the 30s, the mid to high 30s, and, you know, well into double digits, and everybody else, you know, all the other sort of establishment candidates had these single digit leads. And I remember looking at that and thinking, for Trump to lose that large of a lead he'd have to really screw up, you know, like he'd have to really like say something really, you know, that a lot of people got upset with, you know, like John McCain not being a war hero or something. If he said something like that, and then everybody would go, no, you can't. Oh, actually, he could get it. Yeah, he could even do that, and it wouldn't affect him. So
that would be crazy.
The ghost of John McCain, he's still hurting over that, clearly. So, you know, this is a similar kind of lead. Now, obviously, a lot can change, but Biden's looking pretty good right now, according to polling. Michael Alber in the Facebook live chat, hello, says, Trump wants an extra 2 years to make up for the Mueller investigation. We were just taking back the years he stole from Obama with his birther hoax. Wait, who stole? I'm just trying to make sure I'm understanding this correctly. Trump wants an extra 2 years to make up for the Mueller investigation. We were just taking back the years he stole from Obama. Oh, I get it. Yes, because... in other words, Trump stole 2 years with the birther hoax. Michael Aber says he'd have to shoot someone in Times Square. Oh, wait. Yeah, well, Trump did say at one point during the campaign, too. I mean, obviously, he was half joking, right, when he said, you know, I'd have to shoot somebody in the middle of Times Square and I still wouldn't lose any support. I mean, he was kidding in the sense that he wasn't really planning to test that theory, but he was correct. I've always said, I mean, Republicans are so, not all, you know, there are dissenters, you know, Rhonda, of course, who is in the Facebook live chat. She's an example of someone who voted for Trump and now regrets it. You know, there are those folks or someone like Scumpy who continues to support Trump, but is not afraid to criticize him. Scumpy's actually been very critical of Trump at points, even though he supports him. He's not afraid to call him out when he thinks he's wrong. But for the most part, the adulation and devotion that Trump supporters have for Trump is unwavering under any circumstances, no matter. I mean, you know, the guy could make fun of a disabled reporter and Trump supporters either, you know, deny that it happened, call it fake news. You know, or, I mean, you know, there's video of him doing it. There's literally video of Trump doing something that I would have gotten smacked for if I had done when I was a child. Right. But and my parents never hit me, but I would have gotten a smack if I'd made fun of somebody that way. But now they're good with it. So but the thing that I always say, only half kidding, is if Trump got us into a nuclear war, you know, any Americans unlucky enough to survive that at the end of it, you know, laying around, you know, vomiting up bile and poison from the blast. Any Trump supporters unlucky enough to survive would be, you know, laying there going, well, you know, he did what he had to do and he had the courage to do it. You know, Obama never would have gotten us into a nuclear war. He was too much of a wuss. He was a pansy. But Trump's a real president. He wasn't afraid to launch those missiles. And I'm only half kidding when I say that. And the part that I'm kidding about is I don't think Trump's really going to get us into a nuclear war. The part I'm not kidding about is if the worst did happen, I truly do believe you'd have Trump supporters afterward going, well, we're all dying now from radiation poisoning. But wow, what a great president. He did what had to be done. He showed those Russians. It's true. I really absolutely firmly believe that. That's why I think he'll win re-election. I've always said two things. If he survives the Mueller probe, and he appears to have survived it. And if the economy stays on track, and it looks like it's going to, I mean, the economy's good. I don't deny that. You know, jobless rates are, I think, the lowest in 50 years. I mean, there's a lot of positive economic data. We're actually overdue now for a recession, but I hope we don't see it. But so if he survives Mueller and the economy stays good, you know, I think he'll easily win re-election. The economy has a way of trumping absolutely everything else. No pun intended, I promise. But it really, I mean, that is the thing that people care the most about. So I don't see him losing in 2020 unless the economy derails. I really don't. Michael Alber says he's coasting. Yeah, yeah, absolutely. So there's a little bit more to this. We'll get back to this poll. Let's see. So former South Bend, Indiana Mayor Pete Buttigieg, He's in third place with 8%. I'm going to have to learn how to say his name. Well, actually, if he stays at 8%, I might not have to. No, actually, he's a very interesting... Oh, Michael Albert says he's coasting on the economy that Obama left. Oh, absolutely. I mean, we had the economy was doing very well under Obama, and it's continued to do well, and Trump continues to benefit from it. I'm always very skeptical of assigning credit and or blame to the president for how the economy is doing. So, you know, I'm not too excited about giving Obama a lot of credit. But I will say, you know, coming out of the financial disaster, the economic catastrophe that the country found itself in at the end of Bush 41. And by the way, I'm not blaming that or Bush 43, rather. Bush 41 was George H.W. Bush. Bush 43. You know, there were things that had to be done that, you know, everyone in a bipartisan way made sure got done. But Obama did preside over, steady economic growth. It was a sluggish recovery in some aspects, if we're really being honest about it. But it was a recovery, and the economy did improve. And the unemployment rate, which Trump at one point, by the way, said, well, actually, I shouldn't say at one point. I think Trump said on multiple occasions, well, don't give Obama any credit for the unemployment rate. The unemployment rate doesn't actually matter. The president has nothing to do with the unemployment rate. Now, again, I'm hesitant to give credit and or blame to the chief executive when it comes to that particular metric, certainly, because I think there's a million other factors, other than just, you know, what the president does, certainly. And a lot of it's the economy goes in cycles, et cetera. But of course, now Trump is, you know, loves to talk about how great the unemployment rate is. But I mean, if we are going to be fair, you know, in fairness, we can give Obama credit for not doing anything to screw up the economy, and we can give Trump credit for not really doing anything to screw up the economy. One thing I will give Trump some credit for is I really thought that these tariffs would wreck the economy. I thought this is the thing that people are going to look at and go, that was the big mistake. When the whole thing goes sideways, and so far so good, you know. But I mean, I realize too. I mean, he's got other people helping him make these decisions. Oh, hello to Gia in the Facebook live chat. Michael Albert says two wars put a drag on the economy. Yeah, referring to Bush 43. But you know, they employed a pretty easy accounting trick. They just didn't put them on the books, literally. You know, those wars were not part of the budget. Dick Cheney said deficits don't matter. And that's when, the Republican Party, I think, stopped being the party of fiscal conservatism. Now there is no party of fiscal conservatism. You know, we had Greg Moore from Americans for Prosperity on the show. This was a while ago. And he even said, you know, Bill Clinton was actually the last fiscally conservative president this country ever had. You know, W was not afraid of deficits. Gia says we need to build a wall to keep the government out. And she says, hello, hello. So let's see, who else do we have in here? Oh, Elizabeth Warren has 7%. Since he officially entered the race in April, Biden has seen an increase in public support and become the clear front runner in the race. Polls taken since the former VP officially declared have shown him receiving support in the upper 30s to lower 40s, about twice as much as Sanders, his next closest rival. The poll was taken Friday and Saturday among 440 registered voters, which is a very small sample, who identified as Democrats or independents who leaned toward the party. California Democratic Senator Kamala Harris was fourth with 6%. Followed by former Representative Beto O'Rourke, Democrat of Texas, and Senator Cory Booker, Democrat of New Jersey, each with only 3%. Wow. And then you have, geez, this is a lot of people running. Tulsi Gabbard, Julian Castro, John Delaney, Kirsten Gillibrand, Michael Bennett. They all received between 1% and 2%. Tim Ryan, Andrew Yang, Marianne Williamson, don't even know who that is, Jay Inslee, Eric Swalwell, Amy Klobuchar, Jay Inslee, Wayne Messam, don't even know who that is, apparently mayor of Miramar, Florida. They all received between 0 and 1%. I'll be voting for Vermin Supreme again in the primary, by the way. I don't see his name mentioned here. That's very, very unfortunate. I hope I can use the power of this show to give him the Matt Connerton Unleashed bump here in New Hampshire. That would be very exciting. Yeah, we're up to about 124 candidates running for the Democratic nominee. I'm kidding. I'm just terrible at math. It's probably only like 94. Anyway, a lot of folks. Michael Albert says polls don't matter much until Iowa, New Hampshire caucus, and primary. Heidi Hamer is in the Facebook live chat. She says, "Hey there, dude." Well, hey there, Heidi. All right, so Biden enjoying a huge lead. We will get to William Barr in the second hour, but we have to do this. Never seen anything quite like this. And I know to some of you folks, this won't matter at all. The response to this will be butter emails and Benghazi. I know that. But Mediaite reports that hundreds of ex-federal prosecutors have signed a letter saying that Trump would be charged with multiple felonies if he were not president. Multiple felonies. Let's see. Because apparently you can't indict a sitting president. So it says here nearly 400 federal prosecutors who worked in both Republican and Democratic administrations signed a statement proclaiming that the findings put forth by special counsel Robert Mueller would have resulted in felony obstruction charges against President Trump if not for the office he held. And that's why I always say, by the way, I've never believed that he actually wanted to be president, that he intended to win. But he damn sure wants that second term now, doesn't he? In a stunning statement posted on Medium, 370 individuals signed a document that serves as a stunning rebuke of Trump's claims of no collusion and no obstruction. The specific byline reads DOJ alumni statement and opens as follows. Oh, wait a minute. You know what we have to do, right? Yes. Oh, yes. If you're a regular listener, you know. You already know. That's what the hip hop folks say now, too, right? I heard a lot of that the other day. You know, last week we had G-Girl and a couple of hip hop artists here in the studio with us. And I heard the phrase, you already know, quite a bit. And I was like, no, that's why I'm asking you. I'm interviewing you. I don't know. It was a nice moment. Anyway, okay. Yes, ladies and gentlemen, my dear listeners, it is time, by popular demand. Well, actually, I mean, there is no demand because no one requested it, but I'm assuming that you all want this. It is time for one of my infamous dramatic readings. I'm going to now present to you the statement by former federal prosecutors issued today. It is titled DOJ Alumni Statement. All right. Are you ready? I'm going to need a, am I ready? I'm going to need a gulp of water before we do this. Let me just peek at the Facebook live chat. Don't want to miss anything because it's very busy in there today, which is wonderful to see. And I do appreciate all of you. Let's see. I'm going to take a gulp here. All right. Here we go. Statement by former federal prosecutors. We are former federal prosecutors. We served under both Republican and Democratic administrations at different levels of the federal system as line attorneys, supervisors, special prosecutors, United States attorneys, and senior officials at the Department of Justice. The offices in which we served were small, medium, and large, urban, suburban, and rural, and located in all parts of the country. Each of us believes that the conduct of President Trump described in Special Counsel Robert Mueller's report would, in the case of any other person not covered by the Office of Legal Counsel policy against indicting a sitting president result in multiple felony charges for obstruction of justice. The Mueller report describes several acts that satisfy all of the elements for an obstruction charge. Conduct that obstructed or attempted to obstruct the truth-finding process as to which the evidence of corrupt intent and connection to pending proceedings is overwhelming. These include the president's efforts to fire Mueller and to falsify evidence about that effort, the president's efforts to limit the scope of Mueller's investigation to exclude his conduct, and the president's efforts to prevent witnesses from cooperating with investigators probing him and his campaign. Attempts to fire Mueller and then create false evidence, despite being advised by then White House counsel Don McGahn that he could face legal jeopardy for doing so, Trump directed McGahn on multiple occasions to fire Mueller or to gin up false conflicts of interest as a pretext for getting rid of the special counsel. When these acts began to come into public view, Trump made, quote, repeated efforts to have McGahn deny the story, unquote, going so far as to tell McGahn to write a letter, quote, for our files, unquote, falsely denying that Trump had directed Mueller's termination. Firing Mueller would have seriously impeded the investigation for the president and his associates. Obstruction in its most literal sense. Directing the creation of false government records in order to prevent or discredit truthful testimony is similarly unlawful. The special counsel's report states, quote, substantial evidence indicates that in repeatedly urging McGahn to dispute that he was ordered to have the special counsel terminated, the president acted for the purpose of influencing McGahn's account in order to deflect or prevent scrutiny of the president's conduct toward the investigation, unquote. Attempts to limit the Mueller investigation. The report describes multiple efforts by the president to curtail the scope of the special counsel's investigation. First, the president repeatedly pressured then-Attorney General J.F. Sessions to reverse his legally mandated decision to recuse himself from the investigation. The president's stated reason was that he wanted an attorney general who would protect him, including from the special counsel investigation. He also directed then-White House Chief of Staff Reince Priebus to fire Sessions, and Priebus refused. Second, after McGahn told the president that he could not contact Sessions himself to discuss the investigation, Trump went outside the White House, instructing his former campaign manager, Corey Lewandowski, to carry a demand to Sessions to direct Mueller to confine his investigation to future elections. Lewandowski tried and failed to contact Sessions in private. After a second meeting with Trump, Lewandowski passed Trump's message to senior White House official Rick Dearborn, who Lewandowski thought would be a better messenger because of his prior relationship with Sessions. Dearborn did not pass along Trump's message. As the report explains, quote, substantial evidence indicates that the president's effort to have Sessions limit the scope of the special counsel's investigation to future election interference was intended to prevent further investigative scrutiny of the president's and his campaign's conduct, unquote. In other words, the president employed a private citizen to try to get the attorney general to limit the scope of an ongoing investigation into the president and his associates. All of this conduct, trying to control and impede the investigation against the president by leveraging his authority over others, is similar to conduct we have seen charged against other public officials and people in powerful positions. Witness tampering and intimidation. The special counsel's report establishes that the president tried to influence the decisions of both Michael Cohen and Paul Manafort with regard to cooperating with investigators. Some of this tampering and intimidation, including the dangling of pardons, was done in plain sight via tweets and public statements. Other such behavior was done via private messages through private attorneys, such as Trump counsel Rudy Giuliani's message to Cohen's lawyer that Cohen should Sleep well tonight. You have friends in high places. Of course, these aren't the only acts of potential obstruction detailed by the special counsel. It would be well within the purview of normal prosecutorial judgment also to charge other acts detailed in the report. We emphasize that these are not matters of close professional judgment. Of course, there are potential defenses or arguments that could be raised in response to an indictment of the nature we describe here. In our system, every accused person is presumed innocent, and it is always the government's burden to prove its case beyond a reasonable doubt. But to look at these facts and say that a prosecutor could not probably sustain a conviction for obstruction of justice, the standard set out in Principles of Federal Prosecution, runs counter to logic in our experience. As former federal prosecutors, we recognize that prosecuting obstruction of justice cases is critical because unchecked obstruction, which allows intentional interference with criminal investigations to go unpunished, puts our whole system of justice at risk. We believe strongly that, but for the OLC memo, the overwhelming weight of professional judgment would come down in favor of prosecution for the conduct outlined in the Mueller report. If you are a former federal prosecutor and would like to add your name below, click here. All right. There you go. A dramatic reading. I hope you all enjoyed that. And I enjoyed doing it so much so I'm going to give myself a big air horn. All right. Let's do this. It is the top of the hour. We'll get into William Barr in some detail after the break, but... you are listening to Matt Connerton Unleashed. We're live on WMNH 95.3, and I'm going to play a track for you. So a few weeks ago, we had on the show Ape the Grim, and he was here talking about Grimfluence, his new release, which is sort of a compilation of songs. But I found something online from 2009, and one of the folks that he's worked with in the past is Undo Cotti, and they released an album together called Jaw and Order, Ape and under the name Ape and Undo. So it's Ape the Grim and Undo Cotti, Ape and Undo. And I was listening to it online. I was like, oh my God, this is great. So I'm going to play one of their tracks for you. It's the radio edit of a song called So Wrong. And I really like this a lot. So let's give this a listen. And please support local music if you're here in Manchester, of course. Some great local hip hop here. So this is So Wrong by Ape and Undo. And then we'll be back with more Matt Connerton Unleashed right after this. Don't go away.
Look, there's rules to follow, meant not to be broke. Bro. Say, they would dab you with one hand, stab you with the other hand. Right back, you thought it was your man. When he met your girl, he had some other plans. It takes two to tango, but that's just a dance. You hit from two angles, her and her. No wonder why you hurt. Did you dirty, man? I know it. I say, let me get it off my chest and express why I did this. Cause I was on to your secret for a minute. That's my word. Didn't think I'd hear about you at the Freaknik. Proposing indecent to Sigma Phi Steven. Cell number 1-800-223-N. Oh, why you looking shocked like you find it hard believing? Never thought I'd be raspy to check your jeans in. You know I'm wide awake, but you tried to catch me sleeping. And even if I didn't find out that way, let me put you on to something. Steven's my cousin, now how you feel, huh? I had mad thoughts of bringing crazy drama to him. Spice his face, cock and throw the 9-llama to him. But off your friend while I videotape. And throw that tape up in a VCR with a no boo, press play. Dude should have known it was wrong. If he would have caught me on a foul note, he would have sang me the same song. They would dab you with one hand, stab you with the other hand. Right back, you thought it was your man. When he met your girl, he had some other plans. It takes two to tango, but that's just a dance. You hit from two angles, her and him. No wonder why you hurt. Did you dirty, man? I know it. I say, oh yes, it is hard to forget Sarah Marshall. Isn't that dirty like burying a fossil? Gave the box to your boy, let him get the waffle, and he's not loyal. Used to be carpool tunnel, that's your right hand. Used to carpool through the tunnel when you're driving. Goddamn, not him. Hot damn, oh, here we go again.
like a thief does. Never broke in cause you showed him where the key was. Under the doormat locked. With your girl doormat cause that's the doormat knocked. Dad put a Red Sox up by his Red Sox hat. The code we follow has just been cracked. Hoes and pimps say your bitch chose him. But this ain't Oakland, he ain't no. They would tap you with one hand, stab you with the other hand. Right back, you thought it was your man. When he met your girl, he had some other plans. It takes two to tango, but that's just the dance. You hit from two angles, her and him. No wonder why you hurt my friend. They did you dirty, man, I know it. I say.
And I would never wish anything like this upon a good kid for nothing. It's my worst fear confirmed. I was a good kid for nothing. It's not supposed to happen to me, man. Nope, not again. Not from someone who got loyalty on his skin. Not someone from my trap crew. Someone I showed the way. But when your jaw got a bad tooth, you know every cane. To beat the brain out my so-called friend until my head is numb. Cause that's the worst thing that you could do to anyone. And it happens around here so much shit is unreal. Everyone do what everyone feel. How you feel, you go through the day seeing them fake people who have their cake and eat it too. That's what a snake need to do. And they do it like it's nothing. It's disgusting without a doubt. Ain't nothing like that burning in your stomach when you just found out. What a friend is your deed, that's a friend indeed. A friend who bleeds one bite of ass ain't worth losing a friend like me. But you know what, I wanna say thanks just the same. Cause I align with a love and she been through the same thing. Timing's insane, I can't even explain. But it's the same slimy games how my family was made. For those who mess around are the one who they say they love. Catch it from your friend, hit your heart like a fatal slug. You can't say sorry now, you a punk. I hope it chews you up, I hope it chews you up.
They will tap you with one hand, stab you with the other hand. Right back, you thought it was your man. When he met your girl, he had some other plans. It takes two to tango, but that's just the dance. You hit from two angles, her and him. No wonder why you hurt my friend. They did you dirty, man, I know it. I say,
she does make me sick.
As you know you're wrong.
People are crazy.
As you know you're wrong.
Can't trust anybody. This happened to me back in the day. Changed my life. To happen again, like what, 12 years later. Now, this is some high school issue, man. You don't do that to your friends. I'm good now, though, you know? Got somebody very special would never do that to me. Big up to everybody out there who's real with it. Big up to all my real friends. My trap jaw affiliates. Y'all need a new New Year's resolution. Let's try to be a better person. I hope you learned from it though.
Never have. say, join a university if you desire diversity. Ever since the right has been controlling, now you know for whom the bell is tolling. They give me a fright, those strangers are.
We've got to fight the power.
when are the food stamps? You know, you can go down and pick up your cheese now.
Oh, that virtual John Hopwood. He's so cantankerous. Welcome, everybody. It's hour number two. Matt Connerton Unleashed. We are live on WMNH 95.3 in Manchester, New Hampshire. Also on Comcast 97 if you're in Manchester. Streaming at WMNHradio.org and on Facebook via Facebook Live on the Matt Connerton Unleashed Facebook page. I see Fred Bonig from the Daily Ripple has joined us in the Facebook Live chat. Hi, Fred. Fred, call in if you want. I would love to hear from you today at 603-250-6007. And anyone else who would like to call, of course. But Fred was in recently in Washington, D.C. or may still be there, but I doubt, I'm sure he's back now. He was there for the, I think I saw a picture of the back of William Barr's head at one point. But Fred spends a lot of time there, of course. Fred's a journalist, and the Daily Ripple is great. Check it out, thedailyripple.org. But yeah, Fred, I mean, if you're around and you're available, I'd love to hear about how things went there in DC. 603-250-6007. That's the number any of you can call, or of course you can always interact in the Facebook live chat as well. And speaking of William Barr, so the House panel has set a vote on Wednesday to hold Barr in contempt. This is from CNN, CNN.com. House panel sets Wednesday vote to hold Barr in contempt after Department of Justice does not turn over the Mueller report. Oh, so this isn't just about him not showing up for his second hearing. Okay, so this is the latest update as of today. House Judiciary Chairman Jerry Nadler has scheduled a Wednesday vote to hold Attorney General William Barr in contempt of Congress after the Justice Department declined to provide an unredacted version of the Mueller report to Congress. The vote to hold Barr in contempt marks the first time that House Democrats are moving to punish a Trump administration official for denying a congressional subpoena that represents a drastic escalation in tensions between Democrats and the White House. Nadler set Wednesday's Judiciary Committee vote after Barr did not agree by Monday's 9 a.m. deadline to comply with the subpoena for special counsel Robert Mueller's full unredacted report and underlying evidence to Congress. The Justice Department responded to Nadler in a letter on Monday saying it was willing to keep negotiating with the committee in good faith and staff to come to the department on Wednesday, quote, to negotiate an accommodation that meets the legitimate interests of each of our co-equal branches of government, unquote. But Assistant Attorney General Stephen Boyd wrote that the Justice Department was disappointed the committee moved toward contempt and urged Nadler to review the less redacted version of the report that was made available to congressional leaders. And by the way, that less redacted version, my understanding is Nadler would have access to reading it, but would not be able to take any notes or, you know, photograph or copy any of the documents or anything like that. So he'd be able to read it, but that's it. It's funny, when I read that, it reminded me of when they were, during the Obama administration, when they were doing the Trans-Pacific Partnership, and they told members of Congress, you can actually read the TPP. You just can't, but you can't, you know, you can go into this room and read it, but that's it. You can read it. We'll let you read it. It's a big document, by the way, so unless you have a really good memory, you might not absorb much of it. But anyway, so Justice Department spokeswoman Carrie Kupek said in a statement, quote, the attorney general has taken extraordinary steps to accommodate the House Judiciary Committee's requests for information regarding the special counsel's investigation. But to date, Chairman Nadler has not reciprocated, refusing even to read the minimally redacted version of the special counsel's report and imposing novel and unreasonable terms on the attorney general's office to testify before the committee, unquote. The Justice Department last week said in a letter that the subpoena was, quote, not legitimate oversight and an overbroad and extraordinarily burdensome, unquote, request. The heart of the dispute is over the grand jury material in the Mueller report, which Nadler has said Congress is entitled to, but Barr argues he's not legally allowed to provide without a court order. Nadler, excuse me, Nadler on Friday sent Barr a new offer to narrow and prioritize the scope of the evidence that the Justice Department would turn over, but he did not back away from his demand that Barr join him in seeking a court order to provide the grand jury material, something Barr has signaled no interest in doing. If the Judiciary Committee votes Wednesday to hold Barr in contempt, the matter would then be taken up by the full House. And, of course, we now have a democratically controlled House. If the Judiciary Committee votes Wednesday to hold Barr... Oh, I'm sorry, I read that already. Georgia Representative Doug Collins, the top Republican on the Judiciary Committee, said Nadler's decision to vote to hold Barr in contempt was illogical and disingenuous. He said in a statement, quote, "They know the Justice Department is working to negotiate even as they pursue a contempt charge, making their move today illogical and disingenuous. Democrats have launched a proxy war, smearing the attorney general when their anger actually lies with the president and the special counsel who found neither conspiracy nor obstruction," unquote. Well, I would disagree that he didn't find obstruction. We'll get into that. The contempt citation is unlikely to have much practical effect. House Republicans held then Attorney General Eric Holder in contempt during the Obama administration, too. But it ratchets up the stakes for House Democrats and the Justice Department at a sensitive time. Barr's own testimony became a flashpoint for the Judiciary Committee last week after he skipped a scheduled hearing amid a dispute over the format. Barr objected to the committee's insistence that staff attorneys be allowed to interview him. Wednesday's contempt vote is not tied to his testimony, as Nadler has not yet issued a subpoena for Barr to appear. And that, by the way, that clarifies something that I was a little bit confused about. I thought they were moving to hold Barr when I saw this initially. I thought they were moving to hold Barr in contempt for not showing up for that second hearing, but apparently they haven't figured that out yet. In addition, Nadler is seeking to have Mueller testify before the committee on May 15th, though the date is not finalized. But it looks like that is going to happen, which will be fascinating. I'm really looking forward to that. Barr testified to the Senate last... By the way, if you're a... I would say this, and you know, some of you will disagree with me, but I think even if you're a... even if you're a Trump supporter, you should want Mueller to go and to testify. I know Trump doesn't want it, and I'm sure there's been plenty of people on Fox News and on conservative talk radio who are saying, no, it's over. It's like Sean Hannity literally the other night looking in the camera saying, look, it's done, let it go. But I would argue if you're, it's like I said all along with the Mueller probe, if you're so sure your guy's hands are so clean, then what are you worried about, right? And again, I mean, to me, you know, now that even the redacted version of the Mueller report has been released to the public, there's somewhere between 9 and 11, depending on how you count them, instances where Trump may have obstructed justice and could be charged with such were he not a sitting president, as was argued in that letter signed by 370 former federal prosecutors, both Republicans and Democrats, who say, he clearly obstructed justice and should be indicted. But I want to know, I mean, I think the central issue here, well, it's not, maybe I shouldn't say it's a central issue, but it's one of the things that I really want to know more about, and you should too. Even if you are a Trump supporter, you should want to know the truth. Because if you're so sure your guy's hands are clean, then you can finally say truly, you know, what you said initially, but really it's a lot murkier than that, you know, because all the pro-Trump people said, see, no collusion, no obstruction. It's like, well, no collusion. Okay, great. I'm glad. No obstruction? Not so fast. So Mueller testifying would be a way to finally put this to bed, right? Because if you're so sure that this report exonerates Trump, and you're so sure William Barr is an honorable guy, not acting as a partisan, as an ideological partisan, but rather as the attorney general, and discharging his duties honorably as such, if you're so sure of all of that, you should have no problem with Mueller coming and testifying, where I'm sure you think Mueller will say, oh, yeah, no, I think I just had a little bit of concern. See, Barr tried to say, oh, yeah, Bob reached out to me. You know, he sent that snitty letter and we talked. And it turned out, you know, Bob just didn't like the way the media was reporting on it. I mean, that literally is what William Barr said, right? When asked, hey, when you told us before that Mueller and his team had no problems with your letter, your initial statement, which basically said, yeah, you know, all good, nothing to see here. We can all go about our business. Turns out Mueller and his team didn't quite agree with your assessment and had some concerns. And then Barr basically said, well, yeah, the letter, I mean, he literally said this, the letter was probably written by somebody who works for Mueller. You know, the letter's a little snitty, probably wasn't even written by Mueller. But Bob and I talked and it's all good. He was just a little bit worried about how the media, he was worried about how the media was portraying this. So if you really believe that, and by the way, hopefully you're wearing some heavy duty boots as you walk through that particular pasture that William Barr has lured you into. But if you really believe that and you're willing to say, yep, good enough for me, you should have no problem with Robert Mueller coming to testify and sitting down and saying in that hearing, as I'm sure you believe he will, oh, yeah, yeah, it was the media was bothering me. And I felt the media was, why would, it doesn't even make sense. Logically, why would Robert Mueller be complaining to Bill Barr about how the media was portraying things? Barr tried to make it sound like the media was trying to spin it as though the report didn't really exonerate Trump, when in fact it did, according to Barr. So he was really, it seemed like the message he was trying to put across was, yeah, Mueller was frustrated that the media was trying to pick this apart and make it sound like Trump did obstruct justice, when in fact he really didn't. When, by all indications, if you read the letter Mueller sent, which was made public, no, that doesn't seem to be what Mueller was saying. Mueller seemed to be saying the opposite, that Barr underrepresented the fact that Mueller could not exonerate the president. And, in fact, the report seems to present a roadmap for how the Democrats may be able to proceed with impeachment, which they're not going to do. Nancy Pelosi's already said they're not going to do it. They're not going to do it. I know there's some energy among others in Congress to do it. It's not going to happen. I mean, Barr was right about that. You know, Barr said at one point, you know, hey, there's an election in 18 months. Yeah, you're right. And if the economy continues to hold, Trump will probably win a second term. But that's one of the issues here is it appears that Barr lied, committed perjury. He lied under oath when he said, no, I'm not aware of any problems Mueller or anyone on his team had. When then we find out, no, William Barr received a letter, which he called snitty, saying, hey, we got some problems here. Maybe it slipped his mind.
All right. So getting back to this. So Nadler is seeking to have Mueller testify on the 15th, though the date is not finalized. Barr testified to the Senate last week that he had no objections to Mueller testifying. But on Sunday, Trump reversed his previous position and tweeted that Mueller should not testify. Why not? Why not? Why would Trump say that? What's the problem with having Mueller testify? Why would you object to that, Mr. President? Isn't Robert Mueller going to show up and say, oh, yeah, nothing wrong, couldn't find anything, no collusion, no obstruction. It's that darn media again, reading into everything. No, nothing to see here, it's all good. Isn't that what Bob Mueller is going to say? So what's the problem, Mr. President? What are you worried about? On the other side of the Capitol, Senate Judiciary Chairman Lindsey Graham told CNN today that he was open to public testimony from Mueller, too, but only about his March phone call with Barr. Now, the phone call he's referring to is after Mueller sent Barr that letter. I guess Barr called Mueller. And one of the things, according to Barr's own testimony, that he said to Mueller was basically, hey, dude, what's the problem? Why are you sending me a letter? Why don't you just call me? Now, there's a very good reason why Mueller would send a letter. Mueller wanted to make sure that this interaction was documented. And of course, he knew the letter would be released to the public. So this was the way to do that. If Mueller had simply called Barr and they just had a phone conversation, then that's it. They just had a phone conversation. See, now Mueller's concerns, that shows you how seriously Mueller and his team take this and how concerned they are about the underrepresentation of the instances of obstruction of justice by the president. They had to send a letter because that's how you memorialize it. That's how you enter it into evidence, if you will, if I could use that phrase. You know, it's better than a phone call. I mean, that just applies to anything in life, right? How do you document something if you want to make sure it is documented? You literally put it into a document. You know? That's why you don't write anything down that you don't want anyone else to know, right? But if you want people to know something or you want them to have access to information, you write it down. You put it into a letter, and then it is a matter of record. I guarantee you, I 100% guarantee you, Bob Mueller didn't say we need to put this in a letter because he was just feeling bashful and didn't want to call, didn't want to bother William Barr. So he figures, I'll just write him a quick letter. Or according to William Barr, he probably told his secretary or something, Bob Mueller's secretary, hey, can you just write a quick letter to William Barr? And then the secretary wrote something that Barr thinks was snitty. Right? No. I guarantee you Bob Mueller wasn't sitting around going, you know, I don't really like to talk on the phone much, but I know Bill doesn't like to text, so I can't really text him. Maybe I'll just write him a letter. No. No. Bob Mueller sent a letter with a very specific purpose. And we're seeing that reason play out right now. Let's see. So Lindsey Graham has resisted Democratic requests to have Mueller testify on the investigation, but he wrote a letter to Mueller last week that said Mueller could provide testimony if he wanted to clarify anything about what Barr testified about regarding their phone call. Barr told Graham's committee
That Mueller clarified in the call his written objections to Barr's four-page letter, saying that Mueller told him he was concerned with media coverage. And by the way, if you go, I did a dramatic reading of the letter when it was released, so we won't go back and do that. But if you've read the letter, or if you haven't read the letter yet, but you're planning on reading it, which, of course, you can easily access it online. If you intend to read it with the intent of believing what Barr is saying about what Mueller told him during that phone call about the letter, make sure you put your boots on before you read the letter, as you're thinking in your mind about what Barr claims Mueller was really trying to say. Because what Barr claims Mueller told him in that phone call just doesn't match up with what is in the letter. What is in the letter is basically, you really underplayed some of the seriousness and some of the concerns that we have about the president in your presentations proclaiming his exoneration. What is in the letter is, I mean, it is a pretty big leap to go from what is in that letter to, I know I'm belaboring this point, but I'm just saying, it's a big leap to go from what is in that letter to, Mueller was just worried about how the media was covering it. That's all. No big deal. No big deal. Don't worry about it. That's a pretty big leap. Okay. Graham said today he has not heard back after his letter, but that he is open to testimony any way Mueller wants to provide it. But he added the caveat that public testimony would only cover any dispute about the phone call. So Graham, I guess, doesn't want any talk about the letter, but only specifically about the phone call itself. Fred says in the Facebook live chat, Mueller contacted him 3 times in 4 days. Well, there you go. Oh, but I'm sure, you know what, though? I'm sure Mueller just kept contacting him because Mueller was probably sitting around watching MSNBC going, oh, look at this media coverage. Oh, it's so, they don't believe, they don't understand that I've completely exonerated the president. I got to call Bill and say, hey, man, you got to really drive the point home that the president didn't do anything because the media is getting it all wrong. No, I mean, he did it with, you know, he did it for a reason. I'm clicking that link Fred shared. Fred, feel free to call in if you want. Like I was saying earlier, if you're available to, I'd love to hear about your experience in D.C. last week. If you're able to. If you're not, don't worry about it. 603-250-6007. Okay, so this is from Reddit. Mueller contacted Barr 3 times in the 4 days after Barr's summary. So there's some key bullet points here. Less than 48 hours after receiving Mueller's 448-page report, Barr released a summary exonerating Trump on collusion and saying there was insufficient evidence on obstruction. So to be fair to Barr, by the way, because I want to be fair, to be fair to Bill Barr, even though I think he's shown himself to be a partisan ideologue and sees his role as part of his role as AG is protecting the president. I mean, I don't think it's unfair to say that. He's put his finger on the scale pretty shamelessly, in my opinion. However, to be fair to Barr, he did say in his initial summary, he said there was insufficient evidence of obstruction. He didn't say the president was fully exonerated on obstruction. So keep that in mind. Okay. All right. Barr, under oath before Congress, admits that neither he nor Rosenstein reviewed the underlying evidence of obstruction before deciding there was not enough evidence. Mueller contacted Barr 3 times in 4 days following Barr's summary, memorializing 2 of those communications in written form. The level of urgency indicates this is not a minor disagreement, and this is noted in Mueller's second letter to Barr. And again, why do you put something in writing? Because you want a recorded documentation of it. A phone call just isn't going to do. All right. Mueller stressed on two occasions, once before Barr's summary and once after that, that, quote, the introductions and executive summaries of our two-volume report accurately summarize this office's work and conclusions, unquote. We know this from Mueller's second letter to Barr. The detail is actually quite damning. It can be interpreted as Mueller warning Barr not to misrepresent the report. Barr, under oath before Congress, twice denied knowing Mueller's thinking on the subject. And that's where this question of perjury comes in. Because Barr claimed no concerns had been expressed. So there's some, and then there's a, oh, actually, yeah, this is worth going over. I'll do it kind of quickly, but there's a timeline here included in this article that Fred sent. So on March 5th, Mueller meets with Barr to explain that the introductions and executive summaries of our two-volume report accurately summarize this office's work and conclusions. This is noted in Mueller's second letter to Barr. March 22nd, Mueller's report is delivered to Barr's office. March 24th, less than 2 days later, Barr releases a four-page summary exonerating Trump. Barr's summary says Mueller found no evidence of collusion. And while Mueller didn't absolve Trump of obstruction of justice, Barr quickly did. March 24th, in the early afternoon, Mueller reiterates to the department, the introductions and executive summaries of our two-volume report accurately summarize this office's work and conclusions. That same day, Trump tweets, no collusion, no obstruction, complete and total exoneration, keep America great. And of course, that was a lie. I know, big shock, it's Trump. But that was not a total, it was not a total exoneration. I mean, yeah, on collusion, I guess, but not on obstruction, not at all. March 25th, one day after Barr's summary, Mueller sends a letter. Its full contents have not been made public to Barr to say he and his team believed Barr had not adequately portrayed their conclusions. Pointedly, he attached the report's executive summaries as a reminder that his investigators had already done the work of distilling their findings. 2 days later, March 27th, 3 days after Barr's summary, Mueller sends a second letter to Barr to say, quote, the summary letter the department sent to Congress and released to the public late in the afternoon of March 24 did not fully capture the context, nature, and substance of this office's work and conclusions. Let me stop there. There's more in this quote, in this highlight, but let me stop there. That's pretty direct. So that's in that letter, and Barr, when asked about it by Congress, says, no, that I don't know about any concerns. That seems like perjury to me. And that's not what Barr tried to spin it as. Again, Barr tried to spin it as, yeah, we talked on the phone. He was worried about the media coverage. That's all. No. I mean, this is very, very direct. The letter you sent to Congress did not fully capture the context, nature, and substance of this office's work and conclusions. And then went on to say, there is now public confusion about critical aspects of the results of our investigation. And by the way, I think that sentence is the one where Barr, who's, you know, supposed to be some super lawyer, that's how he got the job, right? I think that's a sentence on which Barr, I think that's a sentence that put the idea into Barr's mind. Okay, so I can spin this as, oh, Bob's just worried about the media coverage. That's his concern. He's not concerned that we misrepresented something. This is, at least this is what I'll say. He's just worried about the media coverage. And then Mueller went on to say, there is now public confusion about critical aspects of the results of our investigation. This threatens to undermine a central purpose for which the department appointed the special counsel, to assure public confidence in the outcome of the investigations, unquote. So then we go to the next day, March 28th, 4 days after Barr's summary. Barr and Mueller speak on the phone. In his May 1 testimony before Congress, Barr says he asked Mueller, quote, if he was suggesting that the March 24 summary was inaccurate. And he said no, but that the press reporting had been inaccurate, unquote. So again, right there, hope you're wearing your boots. That's where Barr tries to spin it because he works for Trump and he is a partisan. And that's more important than being the top cop in the country, right? Protecting his guy. So that's him trying to spin it as no, he was just worried about the press reporting. It says here, note, Mueller makes no mention of the press reporting or of media at all in his March 27th letter. Barr testified he has notes of his phone conversation with Mueller. This was an interesting moment. I have the audio of, maybe if we have time, I'll play it, but I want to make sure we get through this. But I was going to maybe play this today. His exchange with Richard Blumenthal, a Democrat of Connecticut, was particularly interesting. They talked about this specifically. Barr testified he has notes of his phone conversation with Mueller, but told Blumenthal that he would not provide those notes to the panel. Why should you have them? Barr asked. That's literally what he said. Why should you have them? April 9 and 10. In back-to-back congressional hearings, Barr disclaimed knowledge. This is when Barr went back, I don't want to get ahead of myself. Okay. So April 9th and 10th. In back-to-back congressional hearings, Barr disclaimed knowledge of Mueller's thinking. No, I don't, Barr said, when asked by Representative Charlie Crist, Democrat of Florida, whether he knew what was behind reports that members of Mueller's team were frustrated by the attorney general's summary of their top-level conclusions. I don't know, he said the next day, when asked by Senator Chris Van Hollen, Democrat of Maryland, whether Mueller supported his finding that there was not sufficient evidence to conclude that President Trump had obstructed justice. I don't know. April 19, Trump tweets, quote, statements are made about me by certain people in the crazy Mueller report. And he actually capitalized crazy Mueller and report. And Trump continues to be all over the place about absolutely everything. You know, oh, the Mueller report completely exonerates me. Now it's the crazy Mueller report. Which is it, buddy? He's all over the place. He's all over the place about Mueller testifying. One day he says, yes, Mueller should testify. Absolutely. Then the next day, no, Bob Mueller should not testify before Congress. Back when, before the Mueller report's released, one day he's, I want the Mueller report to come out. It's going to completely exonerate me. The next day, no, I don't think the Mueller report should be released. Of course not. Should be kept confidential, classified, all over the place, from one minute to the next. Oh, by the way, Fred says in the Facebook live chat, I was sitting right there when he said it. All right, so on April 19th, Trump tweets, statements are made about me by certain people in the crazy Mueller report, in itself written by 18 angry Democrat Trump haters, which are fabricated and totally untrue. Watch out for people that take so-called notes when the notes never existed until needed. Because I never agreed to testify, it was not necessary for me to respond to statements made in the, quote, report about me, some of which are total, and then I can't say that word on the air, and only given to make the other person look good or me look bad. This was an illegally started hoax. And the words started and hoax are both in caps, or both capitalized, not all in caps, but capitalized. That never should have happened. Okay. I thought this whole thing exonerated you, dude. What are you all worked up about? No collusion, no obstruction. Now you're calling it a a hoax and a crazy Mueller report written by 18 angry Democrat Trump haters. His exact words. Mueller's a Republican, by the way, and I'm sure many on his team are as well. And then May 1st, Barr, in his testimony to Congress, admits he did not review the underlying evidence in Mueller's report before deciding that the evidence did not reach the threshold to charge Trump with obstruction, nor did Rosenstein. So they kind of saw what they wanted to see, I think. And, you know, that would have been harder to do had they actually examined the underlying evidence. So that's where we are there. That was helpful, Fred. I'm glad you put that in there. Thank you. Then there's the matter of, and we're almost out of time, so really quickly, factcheck.org, which is a wonderful site, did Barr mislead Congress? Now, this was posted back on, all the way back on May 1st, but it's certainly relevant now. And actually, we have a call. So we'll grab this. We might save that article for another day. Hi, welcome to Matt Connerton Unleashed. Who's this?
It's your old pal, Fred.
Fred!
And you're right. You're right about Mueller not reading it. I mean, Barr not reading it. Because when Cory Booker said to him, well, you know, it's illegal to give polling data to a super PAC. And,
oh, yeah.
And, you know, they gave it to the Russians. And he said, who did? It's like, dude, it's on page 174.
Oh, that's
it
right.
It says, you know, Mueller did it. And that's because he said, if you can't legally give polling data to your super PAC, how can you give it to the Russians? Which was basically the Russian super PAC IRA, you know, the Internet Research Association or agency or whatever.
Yeah.
I mean, because they were spending millions of dollars on Trump. It was the super PAC.
Right. I'd forgotten about that exchange with Cory Booker.
So he never read the report at all.
Yeah.
I mean, not really.
Yeah, yeah.
Because all the things he quoted were on the first page or in the summary.
Right, right. Well,
all the sentences, the partial sentences, were all in the summary.
Right. When you, Fred, in the Facebook live chat, when you said I was sitting right there when he said it, which
I was sitting behind Mueller when he said that.
Behind Mueller or Barr?
I mean Barr. I mean sitting behind Barr when he said that. I was sitting at the Barr hearing. I went to both of them. Went to the one he showed up and the one he didn't show up.
Oh, okay. Now the one he didn't show up, I assume everyone knew.
That's the one with the chicken.
Which I thought was kind of funny.
I thought it was funny.
Yeah. Did
matter of fact, Representative Cohen tagged himself in the picture in my pictures that I took.
Oh, no kidding. Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah.
But no one was surprised, right? Like, I assume in the room everyone knew he wasn't coming.
No, everybody knew he wasn't coming.
Yeah, yeah.
But, you know, they just wanted to do some speeches. And it's funny because, you know, they of course, Matt Gaetz has to get up there and, you know, try to make a statement. And the whole time he's smirking. And you know, it's the same thing as when Donald Trump said that Putin smiled.
Yes.
How is that smirk? You know that smirk that he always has?
Yes.
When somebody says, did you get involved in the, oh, not us. We would never do that.
Right.
And he always has that, like, smirk on.
Right.
I mean, really. We are in some kind of dystopian, you know, craziness now.
Yes. To be fair to Trump, though, the thing about Putin smiling, I mean, sometimes on the phone you can kind of hear a smile in someone's voice. You know, they always tell, like, people who go to work in call centers, you know, make sure you smile with your voice. You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah, I always know that. My boss told me when I started in radio, smile when you open the mic because your listeners can tell.
There you go. And Donald Trump is such a stable genius. He could really pick up on that Putin was smiling.
Oh, I would have guaranteed Putin was laughing.
That would have been even better if Trump said that, you know.
Yeah. Oh, you mean they didn't find anything? Can you imagine all those Americans? And they're so good at figuring things out, too, huh?
Oh my goodness.
Oh.
Yeah.
Well, all I know is that there's a great song on Randy Newman's Dark Matters, and it's called Putin. And it's I played it this morning just because it talks about Putin. You know, Putin's the man. He's the guy. You know.
Oh, geez. Maybe I'll play that to wrap up the. Maybe I'll play that to wrap up the show.
It's on Dark Matters. It's Randy Newman's, and it's called Putin.
Okay, and it's clean, obviously, because you played it.
Oh yeah, I play it all the time.
Yeah. Oh really? Okay. Yeah, I didn't even know about it. Wow. All right, I'll probably, I'm looking it up now. I'll probably play that to wrap up the show. All right, Fred.
Okay, well, you have fun, boss, and keep going.
All right, man. Thank you so much for the call.
Bye.
All right, bye-bye. All right, the great Fred Bonick from the Daily Ripple, who was there. He was on scene, as they say. I found it online here, yeah. Randy Newman, Putin. I didn't even know about this song. I think I will play this. To play us out, as Bill O'Reilly once famously said. All right, so we got to go. Thank you so much, Fred, for the call. Thank you to everybody in the Facebook live chat. Busy day in there today. Let's see. Tomorrow, I don't know. I guess tomorrow we'll see what happens. As always, a million. You know, I do actually do show prep. I know it probably doesn't seem like it, but sometimes it really is true that there's so much going on. It becomes difficult to choose. What to go with. And we only have 2 hours. We live in, thanks, Fred. Fred posted the link also in the Facebook live chat. But we live in such interesting times, as always, so much to discuss. But we're going to get out of here for now. If you missed any part of today's show, it'll be up in just a little bit at WMNHradio.org. I'll be back tomorrow. I'll talk at y'all a little bit later. And to wrap up, this is Putin by the great Randy Newman. To finish out today's Matt Connerton Unleashed. Bye, everybody.
Putin putting his pants on one leg at a time.
IBMNation.com.